How many of you got something out of last week's message about the millennium? Amen? You know, it boggles my mind how many believers, I know I always say this, know so little about the scripture. All they know is what the preachers have talked about, which is basically, you know, some of the gospels, not even in the right context, some of the epistles of Paul, and then it's like we forget there's 66 books in the Bible, and what's cool about the scriptures, they all fit together. From Genesis to Revelation, everything fits, and you'll never get a true understanding of the scripture until you take all the scripture in its context. Okay? And so what typically happens is preachers who don't understand parts of it, we just ignore it, and we just never teach on it, never study it, and we say, well, we just don't need it. I believe that all the scripture is in your Bibles for a reason. How many of you believe that? How many of you believe we serve a big God? And that God, if he didn't want but just a couple books in there, would have put just a couple books in there. How many of you think that? So how many of you think he has all that in there because he's trying to tell us something? Amen? He knows that you and I have a difficult time in this life. And the reason, did I do that? The reason we have a difficult time in this life is because we can't see with our eyes. We see with our eyes of faith. Amen? But the day is coming where we will see with our eyes. So he places enough information in the scripture to try to build our faith. How many of you could find that you always need more faith? How many of you find that your faith kind of leaks out of you sometimes like a leaky sieve? Amen? And the millennium and our understanding of the Lord's plan in the end times to restore this planet, to establish a government, and what you and I are going to be doing during that millennium is of the utmost importance. This idea that we're going to die and spend eternity in heaven, even though it sounds great and it makes for great songs, isn't in the Bible. Someone say amen.
Amen.
Thank you. It's not there. Okay? It's not there. You don't have to take my word for it. Go home and read your Bibles. It's not there. Now, we're going to be in heaven if you were to die today and you knew the Lord. You're going to be with the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Amen? But the Lord's not staying in heaven. He's only there until he returns back to this planet. Someone say amen.
Amen.
And he is coming back to this planet. Whether human beings believe it or not, did you know that the Muslims have taken the Eastern Gate where it's prophesied in the scripture that Messiah is going to come through, and they've put a Islamic cemetery there to block Messiah because they know Messiah, I mean, they're like, well, he can't touch anything dead. So they think their cemetery is going to keep Messiah from coming through the Eastern Gate. Did y'all know that? So somebody somewhere is taking this stuff seriously. So much so they're putting dead bodies there. Now, how many of you think that cemetery is going to stop Jesus from coming through the gate when it's time? I mean, it just... We human beings, the things we do, and I mean, anyway, I won't even get off into that. All right, so the millennium. It's important that we understand the scripture. It's important that we understand God's plan for the ages. Amen? You say, well, how's it affect my life today? Well, A, it should build your faith. Because we get so focused in on what we see today, and we don't recognize God has this huge, big old grand plan that's unfolding before our very eyes that we don't even realize. Amen. So today I want to talk to you about the human lifespan during the millennium. I want to talk to you about God's health plan during the millennium. Do you know he has a health plan? And how many of you know, or if you don't know, you will know, it's a lot better than Obamacare. Okay? It's the millennial health plan of the ages. And it's coming. Did you know that there's some more animal kingdom changes that are going to take place and some other things? So I want to hit on a few of those. And then next, we're still not done after today. So there's a whole lot more. So we're going to just continue to plug our way through it. So I'm going to kind of set it up by chapter in the teaching today, a little bit different. But this way, I want to make it as simple and as concise as possible. So let's pray together and let's ask the Holy Spirit to help us understand. Heavenly Father, we bless you. We thank you for the good word of the Lord. Father, we thank you that our faith will be built and will stand the test of time when our faith is built on the scripture and not on presumption, not on assumption, not on songs or even hymns from the ages, Lord, but when our theology is built on the everlasting word of God. For you said in the scripture that heaven and earth will pass away, but your word shall abide forever. And Father, speak through me to these your people today, that their faith might be built in the everlasting hope of your coming soon restoration and kingdom to this planet. In the name of Jesus. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen and amen. And if you did miss part one, as Miss Linda said, it is on YouTube available. Let's get started. Now, last week's circle stuff was so small, I designed this myself to make it bigger so you can see it and hopefully follow it. The scripture tells us that there are different dispensations or different ages. How many of you know that God is timeless and he changes not? Amen? As we see in our scripture up here, Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. In the Old Testament, Exodus, I am the Lord and I change not. He doesn't change, but the manner and the means in which he deals with human beings has always changed. And each changing period is known as a dispensation or an age or a time period. Right now, you and I are in what is called the age of grace. Everyone say grace. Grace. Now, before the time of Messiah, they were under the age of law or the dispensation of law. Okay? Now we're under the dispensation of Messiah, the age of grace. There is a coming a time. As y'all know, I've taught on it, the seven-year tribulation, okay? It's a different dispensation. I just call it the tribulation. Then there's coming a time, and this is the time period that I'm speaking of today, last Sunday, and next week, the 1,000-year reign of Messiah. That's a different age. God hasn't changed, but the way in which he responds and deals with human beings and deals with the nations does change. Does everybody understand it? Okay? And then after that 1,000-year period, and God's very specific, 1,000 years. Matter of fact, when God says 1,000 years, guess how many years he's talking about? 1,000. He's not talking about 1,001. He's talking about 1,000. We serve a detailed God. Amen? You can't read the scripture and not know that. You can't look at the universe or a human being or creation and not know that we serve a detailed God. It just boggles my mind. They're talking about the Hadron Super Collider finding even new particles now. They thought they had all the particles. They thought they had this whole thing figured out. Now they realize there's a whole new set of particles. Listen to me, there's probably particles on particles on particles. And they're going to be spending the rest of eternity, if they had it, which they don't, trying to figure this thing out. That's how detailed and awesome God is. But look at this. Then after that 1,000-year reign of Messiah, we have eternity to come. You mean the scripture, the Bible teaches that there's going to be things that happen during that period? Yes. Wow. I didn't even know that. I thought we're just going to be playing harps and looking like babies in the clouds. I'm glad that's not our future. Hallelujah. Someone say amen? Now, I like looking at the clouds. Are you with me? Maybe not from an airplane, but from the ground. I'm not an airplane person. I like looking at the clouds. But the idea of having a harp and just floating for eternity just doesn't do a lot for me. But this, God's plan and the things he has in store, man, it's exciting. I mean, he actually has things for us to do. Amen? Someone say amen. Amen. All right, thank you. All right, let's get started here. Now, the first thing I want to do is a quick review of last week. Last week, we talked about how Satan is going to be at the very onset, at the very start of the 1,000-year reign of Jesus on this planet. When Jesus comes back, Satan, the devil, Lucifer, that snake of old, the fallen cherub, he is going to be placed in chains for 1,000 years. Yes, he's going to be placed in physical chains and imprisoned in the abyss for a 1,000-year period. Okay? Everybody understand it? We talked about Messiah. Jesus is coming physically to this planet. Amen? He is going to physically set his feet on the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives is going to split just as he left off. You remember he was standing on the Mount of Olives, talking to his disciples, giving them the Great Commission, and all of a sudden he lifted off the plane. He didn't just vanish. He literally, physically, went up slow. And they're just staring, which you can't blame them. I'd be staring too. Amen? They're just... And suddenly an angel appeared and said, "You men of Galilee, why do you stand here with your mouths wide open looking up at him? The same way in which he left is the same manner in which he's coming back." Amen? Now, they thought it was going to be like in a year or two. Okay, we know differently now, don't we? God had this whole plan and has this whole plan to bring the Gentile nations. You say, well, why has he waited so long to bring people to Christ? Listen. Number one, he gives people freedom of choice. Number two, did you realize that there are more human beings alive on this planet today than have ever existed in the history of the planet at all times? If you took all human beings that ever exist on the planet, there's more humans alive today than all those people added up. So these are the times God is bringing in the great harvest. We talked about some of the animal changes. We talked about the wolf. That's a wolf, supposed to be a wolf, laying down with the lamb. Okay, right now, if you put wolves and lambs, you end up with lamb chops. Okay, I love lamb. They treated us superintendents Friday night to a beautiful Brazilian steakhouse meal. You know, what we do is unpaid, and so that's their way of blessing us. And, you know, I just kept asking for the lamb. Bring me the lamb. And so they brought the rack and just... Keep shaving, buddy, because I just love lamb. But in that day, there won't be eating any lamb, neither for the wolf nor for me or anybody else. There'll be no eating of meat during that time, okay? So the wolf is going to lay down with the lamb. Then we talked about how the capital of the entire planet is going to be Jerusalem. Isn't it amazing that a nation that's about the size of Rhode Island is the center of all news all the time, it seems? For such a small little country, there's a reason for that. God has a plan for that city, amen? And that's where Messiah is going to rule the planet from. Israel, we talked about how during that time, God's going to bring all the Jewish people out of all the nations and bring them back to the land. He's already been doing that, but he hasn't taken them out of all the nations. Okay, a lot of people are immigrating to either Israel or coming to America, mainly the Jewish people. Okay, but God's going to bring them out of all the lands back to the nation of Israel at the start of the millennium. Now we get into fresh stuff. Okay, that was a quick review if you missed last week. Human life during the millennium. Now, I like this picture. Okay, now you ladies can relate, but you can put kind of a male thinking. This was you. As a baby, how many of you remember being a baby? Ladies, men, okay? How many of you remember being a little kid? Seems like a long time ago. Anybody want to admit that? Anybody? Anybody? Nobody wants to admit that? Okay. You were a little kid. And here you're bigger, and then you're a teenager, young woman, and then, of course, that's an elderly woman with her cane walking. Okay, so I want to talk to you about the human lifespan or the human life cycle during the millennium. Now, as I start this teaching, I want you to understand two things. There are two type of people that you need to understand who are going to be in the kingdom of God. Okay, there are those who are believers who have been resurrected. Everybody say resurrected. What's resurrected mean? That means you are either dead, like Jesus. He was resurrected with a physical body, or it means you are raptured and your body is changed to a new glorified body anyway. Someone say amen. Now, those people will never die, okay? But then there's another type of people, and those are the people I want to talk about. Those are the people who make it alive and become believers during the seven-year tribulation. Entire nations, the scripture teaches, will come to the kingdom of God, will come to faith in Christ during the seven-year tribulation. And those people who make it alive during that period as a believer, they'll enter into the reign, into the thousand-year kingdom of Jesus, alive as human beings. Okay? That's where things get interesting, because they'll be able to have babies, and those babies will have babies, and those babies' babies will have babies, and it'll continue. But something's weird and different about it, and I want to explain it to you. Let's look to Scripture. This Isaiah chapter 65, starting in verse 20. It says, there shall, this is the whole thing in context, speaking of the millennium, okay? There shall no more be in it, in the kingdom of God, in the planet, on the world, an infant who lives but a few days. How many of you have heard of children dying? I had the displeasure of having to bury a baby once. Our youth pastors at our first church lost a newborn baby girl, and they released balloons, and it was a beautiful funeral, but it was hard. I mean, it's like, man, you know? But that's, you have to understand, that's the planet fallen in which we live. Hard things happen all the time. But that's not going to be when Jesus restores this planet to the way it was originally designed. An infant, there will no more be an infant who only lives a few days, or an old man who dies prematurely. For the child shall die 100 years old. Let me stop there for a minute. What does that mean, die 100 years old? Listen, people are going, who make it and survive into the millennial kingdom, are going to live so long that if they die at the age of 100, it'll be as if they died as a child. Do you understand that? Now, how many of you would like now to live to be 100? I mean, if you die at 100, you think, whew, boy, that's a pretty good age. Then you die at 100, and it'll be as if a child died. Then it says, for the child shall die 100 years old, and the sinner who dies when only 100 years old shall be thought only a child, cut off because he is accursed. In other words, if somebody dies at the age of 100, they're going to think that, man, they must be punished by God because they died so young. Are you following me? That's what it's saying. So during the millennial kingdom, people are going to live for the 1,000 years. They're going to see their children, their children's children, their children's children's children, their children's 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 children, and you can take that and stretch it out for the 1,000-year period. Because there may not be a lot of people who enter into the kingdom at first, who make it and survive through the tribulation period, but you can see how rapidly the population's going to explode during that 1,000-year period of time. Now, let's take a look at this. So babies no longer die in infancy. How cool is that? Amen. No more birth defects, no more diseased children. Babies no longer die in infancy. Everyone will live out their lifespan. Their lifespan in this case is 1,000 years. How cool is that? Amen. How many of you have ever lost a loved one? It's a painful separation, even though they, you know, they're with the Lord. Amen. Lost my best friend a couple years ago. I mean, it's still, there's pain involved in that because there's grief. There's a departure, okay? Those who die at age 100 will be considered having died as a child. That just blows me away. That's just awesome. And to die as a child less than 100 years of age would be looked upon as a punishment from God. Okay, so this is the lifespan of that 1,000-year period. Okay, so I want you to picture how quickly the earth's going to repopulate. And I want you to picture, and also I'm like in the future on this, but I want to plant a seed in your mind. These people still need to, for themselves, receive the Lord. Now you say, that doesn't sound right. I mean, Jesus is there living amongst them. How many of you know God has given us freedom of what? Everybody say choice. He didn't make robots. And even the people born during the millennial kingdom still have to make a choice to follow Jesus. And you're going to see with me in the weeks to come as we complete the study of the millennium that multiplied millions of them at the end of the 1,000 years make the wrong choice. The wrong choice. How can that be? Again, it has to come from our heart to choose to love and serve him. Amen? Put a bug in your ear about that. Isaiah 65, verse 21 through 23. Now, this is, again, talking about human beings, what we're going to be doing, some of what's going to be happening. not us who are resurrected, but those who make it alive into the thousand-year kingdom of Christ. It says, and they shall build houses. Everybody say, build houses. That sounds pretty good. So they're going to, it's not like God's going to zap a house, boom, this one's for you. They're going to be building houses. Y'all understand that? That means they're going to have a place to live, a place for their family, a place to raise children. Now, what's cool about that, remember, she'll be raising kids. They'll be 100 years old and still thought to be a child. Now, that might not sound too good to some of us who have raised teenagers or kids, because it'd be like, really, you're how old, 98 years old? I'm still having to tell you this? No. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They're going to live in them. They shall plant what? Vineyards. How many of you like to plant gardens? Okay. Now, again, this isn't talking about you because you're resurrected. Okay? You're in a different age. Everybody understand? You're either going to die or get raptured before this takes place. Okay? But the people into the kingdom, they're going to plant vineyards. A vineyard is what? Where you grow things. Okay? Typically grapes. So they're going to be growing fruits and vegetables and gardens, and they're going to be eating the what? Fruit of them. So they're going to have food. They're going to grow the food. They're going to eat the food. Pretty simple. So they're, again, human beings, but they're still, even though they're in the millennial kingdom of God, they're still going to be eating and planting and raising fruits, vegetables, and things of that nature. Verse 22, and they shall not build another inhabit. Well, why is that? That's because they're going to live so long. How many of you own a house? Not outright, but own a house. Okay? Listen, you own that house, but what happens after you die? Typically, either your children inherit it, or it goes to an estate sale and it gets sold. Am I right or am I wrong? So we own our house, we own it while we're alive. Okay? You stop living, you no longer own your house. Somebody else is going to own it, even if it's relative. So here it says, they shall not build another inhabit. Why? Because they're going to live so many years. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree are the days of my what? People. How cool is that? For as the days of a tree, so are the days of my people. How many of you have ever, I've never been. Matter of fact, Miss Claudia, this Sunday and next Sunday is on spring break, and she's on a road trip to California, okay, to Los Angeles. And the school she's at, they just travel all the time. But anyway, they're on a road trip, which is cool. And so on this road trip, I'm not sure, but in California, there's these redwoods. Have you ever heard of the redwood forest? Have you ever seen the redwood forest or a picture of the redwood forest? Are they big, Utah? They're big trees, aren't they? I mean, I saw one postcard as a kid I'll never forget, and it showed a road with a tunnel carved out of the tree, a two-lane highway. And the tree went over the whole thing. And I was thinking, man, that tree's got to be old. So when the Lord says that the days of a tree are as the days of my people, what's he saying? He's saying that his people are going to be living a long, 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 long time. Amen? Have you ever seen Groundhog Day? How many of you remember that? Remember this guy? Who was the star of that? Bill Murray, thank you. Bill Murray. So Bill Murray stars in this movie, if you hadn't seen it. And what happens in this movie is for some reason he wakes up and keeps repeating the same day over and over and over and over again. And at first he's like so discouraged because the same thing keeps happening. And then he begins to wake up and realize, hey, wait a minute, I have all this time, I can do a lot of things with my life. He learns how to become a concert pianist. Man, he learns how to become an artist. He learns all these things they never took the time or had the time to do. Then all of a sudden, he finds true love. And once he finds true love, he wakes up and the day has finally changed. But all those skills, now he can play the piano, he's an artist, and he just blows people away with what he's learned. Can you imagine the people that live during that thousand-year period, how much they'll be able to work on their own life during that period, and the things they'll understand and know? And so that's the thinking. That's what I want you to get across when you think of the millennium. For as the days of a tree are the days of my people, and my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. Now listen, we think of 100 years today as being a long time. The Bible says that your life at best is like a vapor of smoke, here for a moment and gone the next. Amen? So, you know, we're comparing it to somebody that lives to a younger year, but the days are coming where 1,000 years is the lifespan. And that's pretty darn exciting for those people that make it alive into the millennial kingdom. Amen? Verse 23, they shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth for trouble. In other words, you're not going to be working your heart out just to leave it to somebody else. For they are the seed of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring are going to be what? With them. How cool would it be to see your children and to see their children? How many of you have grandkids? How many of you know that your grandkids are like the little love of your life? Am I right? I don't have grandkids, but I've heard. I mean, it's pretty neat, right? You love them. They're awesome. How many of you think it'd be cool if you got to see your grandkids' kids? That'd be your great-grandkids. What if you had great-great-great-great-grandkids live in the house? I mean, I'm going back some years. So these people are going to see their offspring. I mean, it might be a couple with, you know, 1,000 people in their family tree who are still alive. I mean, it kind of blows your mind, doesn't it? But that's what it's going to be like. And the scripture tells us that. Why? To build our faith. Now, I want to talk to you now. We talked about the human lifespan. The next little chapter is answered prayer. Prayer during the millennium. You mean there's going to be prayer during the millennium? Yes, there is. And the scripture I want to give you and share with you, oftentimes people who have the gift of prophecy use this scripture, and it has layers of meaning, but I'm going to give you the true context of the scripture, which is it's talking about the millennium, okay? And in the truest form of the scripture, and let's take a look at it, Isaiah 65 again, verse 24. And this is during the millennial kingdom in context. And it shall come to pass that before they call, I will what? Answer. Now, let's be honest, guys. We like to quote that today, but that's not the world we live in. Sometimes, matter of fact, I'd say most of the time when we're praying about things in our life, we're having to battle through in prayer. Am I right or am I wrong? How many of you know that we have to do spiritual warfare? That there's an enemy of our souls, that when you pray, you've got to fight and ask and keep on asking, seek and keep on seeking, knock and keep on knocking. And it's not because God doesn't want to answer it, but there are principalities and powers and demonic forces that are always trying to hinder the people of God and hinder our prayers before God. And Daniel taught this. Remember, he fasted and prayed in the book of Daniel in the Old Testament. He fasted and prayed to the Lord. The angel appeared to him like all these weeks later, said, Daniel, we heard you the first day, but the prince over Asia withstood me. In other words, there was these demonic forces that kept me from bringing an answer to you. All that's gone during the millennium. And so when people call, the Lord's going to answer. He says, while they're yet speaking, I will hear. How awesome. Amen. Then it goes on, says, before you even have before you even have a chance to pray, your answer comes. Now, how many of you know the Lord hears you now? Amen. But like I said, how many of you know the scripture teaches that we have to wrestle through in prayer? Amen. Wrestle through. Before you even have a chance to pray, your answer comes during the millennium. How cool is that? Well, I was just going to pray, but boom, it's already done. That's not how we live today, amen? Now, does that happen at times? Yes, but that's not all the time. So hear what I'm saying, okay? While even your prayers are escaping your lips, your Heavenly Father during the millennium, He's responding. That's pretty awesome, amen? All right, next thing. Y'all like this, healthcare. How many aging baby boomers do we have here? You don't have to raise your hand, I see. I'm kidding. I'm an aging baby boomer. I think 1964 was the last year of the baby boomers. I was born in 64. So if you were born in 65 on up, you're not considered a baby boomer. You're whatever the next group of folks were called, huh? So, healthcare during the millennium. How many of you think God is going to have an awesome healthcare plan? How many of you wish you had better health care? I was talking to Bill. He and Rella aren't here this morning. She'd been suffering with a broken foot, and she'd been waiting forever to see a doctor. And I want to talk to you this morning about the real healthcare plan that God has for his people during the millennium. And this is pretty darn awesome. And this is again out of the book of Isaiah, and this is Isaiah chapter 35. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. So, if somebody makes it through alive that seven-year tribulation, they come into the kingdom of God, but they've been blind during that seven-year period, or they've been deaf during that seven-year period, or missing an arm or a limb or whatever it is, they come into the kingdom of God, all of a sudden they're made whole. Completely and totally. Everybody understand that? Then shall the lame man leap like a deer. I can't quite do the deer thing, but my leg's not wanting to go up. But what does it mean to be lame? Somebody that has a hard time walking or can't walk. Somebody that's in a wheelchair. Okay? They're going to be leaping like a deer. Hallelujah. Now again, this isn't the resurrected saints, because your body's already going to be like that. You and I, when our bodies are changed, our bodies, the Bible says, are going to be just like Jesus' body. Amen? I mean, he was able to move with the speed of thought. I mean, we're in a whole another realm. We're in a whole nother same place, but we're in a whole nother dimension? Sphere? All right. Thank you, guys. Y'all just keep it. Y'all keep preaching for me. I'm kidding. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer, the tongue of the mute sing for joy. Have you ever met somebody who's mute, somebody couldn't talk? Not too many mutes around anymore, but I'm sure they're out there. Their tongue's going to be loose. They're going to be able to sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. So the first thing you and I need to understand is that the onset at the start of this 1,000-year period where Jesus comes back to the planet, establishes his government, he's ruling over the earth. At the onset of that, everyone who makes it alive through the tribulation period, who is a believer and is allowed entrance into the kingdom of God, anything that's wrong with them will no longer be wrong with them. How's that for a summary? Pretty awesome, amen? Let's look at some more of God's health care plan for the millennium. Ezekiel 47:12. Now this is neat. When you go earlier in Ezekiel, and we'll get there in another message, another teaching, it talks about God's temple in Jerusalem, okay? And it talks about this river of water coming out of this temple from underneath it. It talks about how wide and deep the river is. And this river, it flows from the temple of God in Jerusalem, goes down to the Dead Sea. How many people here have ever been to Israel? Anybody? Okay. Have you ever been to the Dead Sea? The Dead Sea is like 1,500 feet below sea level. It is used to be like ocean water, but it's evaporated so much water that all that's left is water and so much salt, magnesium and calcium chloride right now. As a matter of fact, the greatest salt mines on the planet are from the Dead Sea. How many of you ever go to the mall and they advertise all the Dead Sea minerals there in Israel? And then they mark it up 10,000 times and sell to you guys at the mall in Abilene. Now listen to you ladies. During this time, this stream comes out of the temple, and I'm ahead by a week or two, but I want to plant a seed in you. It goes down to the Dead Sea and makes the Dead Sea come alive again, just so you know. And fish and all kinds. Right now, nothing lives in the Dead Sea. Matter of fact, did you float in the Dead Sea? You can go in the Dead Sea, and even if you can't swim, you can float. It just holds you up. That's how much salt it is in there. Okay, pretty cool. But from this stream that comes from the temple of God in Jerusalem, it says that on both sides of this river, there will grow all kinds of trees for food. Their leaves won't wither, nor their fruit fail, but they will bear fruit, fresh fruit, every month. How cool is that? Can you imagine having, how many of you have a fruit tree at your house? Anybody? What kind of fruit? All right, can you imagine having a plum tree? I love plums, purple plums. Can you imagine having a plum tree that bears plums every single month? Awesome. Now, these trees on both sides of this river, it's coming out of the temple of God in Jerusalem during the 1,000-year reign of Christ. It says, not only does it bear fruit every month because the water for them flows from the sanctuary, from the temple, but their fruit will be for food and their leaves for what? Healing. Everybody say for healing. So the leaves of these trees that are on both sides of this river that's flowing out, the future temple that's going to be built in Jerusalem, the leaves of these trees are used for the healings of the nations. How cool is that? Amen. Is this building your faith? I mean, the Lord's got this stuff planned, doesn't he? Let's go on. Let's talk about the animal kingdom as we wrap it up. Isaiah 65, still in Isaiah. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like the bullock. Right now, lions, if you had a zoo, where's Kenny? Pastor Kenny, if you had a zoo and that zoo had a real lion and you tried to feed him straw, if he could laugh, he would laugh at you. How many of you think that's true? He'd be like, I don't want any straw, buddy. I need some meat. But during the millennium, the lion shall eat straw like the bullock, like the cow. And dust shall be the serpent's meat. How many of you remember the serpent, the snake? How many of you remember that, you know, however you want to think of it, some people think that the serpent gave its body over to Satan to inhabit. However your theology wants to run in that, doesn't change the story at all. Just know that snakes are going to be eating dust for their food during the millennium. How many of you don't like snakes, ladies? Okay. So right now, snakes don't eat dust. They eat mice, they eat rodents, they eat creatures, critters. But during that time, they're going to be eating dirt. Okay, that's the only thing they eat. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, saith the Lord. Amen? Let's stand to our feet. Listen, our Lord, our God, has a bright future for his people. Amen? A bright future for this planet. Don't ever get your eyes so focused on all the turmoil and the confusion and the distress in this planet and the people in the planet that you or I forget that God has a great plan. And his plan hasn't changed. He's not worried. Amen? Everybody say, God's not worried.
God's not worried.
He is not worried about anything. Everything is under control. All we have to do is recognize that, you know what? When you see these things coming to pass, Jesus said, look up, for your redemption is drawing near. Amen. We still got a lot more to talk about. That's the people who were alive during the millennium. I still want to talk to you about what we're going to be doing as resurrected believers. Since we've realized, Scripture doesn't teach, we're going to be floating on clouds playing harps. We're going to be doing something. Amen. And then we're going to talk about what happens at the end of that thousand-year reign of Christ as well. And it's not a pretty thing at all. So let's go ahead and let's close in prayer. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Prayer.